I'm Jaime Bonato, teacher on special assignment for San Juan Unified School District. I support secondary math teachers in professional learning and curriculum. Yesterday we started the lesson and did the beginning of the lesson, which was introducing the learning goals and the success criteria. So I shared with the class that they were going to be identifying graphs showing the relationship between two quantities, and then using reasoning, be able to justify their answer. And by the end of the lesson, I wanted them to be able to write an if-then statement, clarifying what their thinking was at the end of the lesson in terms of relationships between two quantities. So today we picked up the lesson by reviewing those intended learning outcomes. Okay, I just want to remind you of the learning goal and success criteria from the lesson that we started yesterday, and we're going to continue today. And looking at their ideas of what a quantity was, and their if-then statements, and then quickly referring back and remembering that yesterday we were graphing the relationship between two quantities. I've used your work from yesterday to put you into groups. So that's, I did read over this, and thank you, those of you that had nice comments for me. Also, like a smiley face, or I really liked, because I asked you to rank on a scale of 1 to 5, and some of you got really creative. Whoever put 3.14, you just made my day. So today's lesson, we started out looking at containers. And I showed them a physical example of what two containers would look like, and I used small vases. We filled them with water of equal volume and looked at the height of the water in those two containers.
Each of these water bottles has the same amount of water. If I were to pour it into those containers, just think to yourself, which one is the height going to be higher?
The idea was that students would start to get a contextual understanding and be able to see what they were going to be working on later, abstractly, in a more concrete example.
Oh, look at the vocabulary. The hypothesis was correct. Okay, so
from there, I was able to launch the lesson. Students were given the task, and on the task, it had 6 different shape containers. So students were given a few minutes to work on the task individually to kind of get their thinking going and get their minds wrapped around the task for the day.
Did anyone get started? And I just want an idea of how you started to think about this problem. Any ways that you started? Yes, ma'am.
I thought about pouring water at a steady rate, thinking about if it would go slower or faster if the vase was narrower or wider.
I looked at the shape of the bottles and tried to decide which graph would probably best show the rate of water going into that shape of vase.
They then were regrouped into triads, and I had assigned the groups based on their thinking from the day before. So I used the evidence that I found from listening to students and from the work that they submitted the previous day. So I had some students that were very solid on the concept of graphing the relationship between two quantities, and some students that were still developing those skills in the same group to be working together. So once they were in their groups, they were able to share their initial thinking, and then I gave them cutouts of the graph and the container and used it so that they can have a matching activity. I thought it would be easier for groups working together to be working with the cards that they were able to manipulate and move around instead of all sharing the same piece of paper, just for ease and flow of they could easily change their thinking and representation of the thinking if they had the cards.
And I want you to just work in your group for about 5 minutes to try to start to match those up and talk about, as you're putting them together, why you think things match up. And feel free to change your thinking. So take 5 minutes and I'm gonna check in as a group and see how you guys are doing.
As I was walking around and listening to the groups, I was jotting down keywords that I was hoping to hear from the group. So I was hoping to hear words such as rate, increase, quicker, slower, faster. And so as I went by each group, I was jotting down the words that I had heard that group say. And if I felt comfortable that they were on to the correct ideas about the relationship between the volume and the height, then I'd move on to the next group.
Because it starts off really slow, but then it gets faster, but then it gets slow.
Okay, so this wouldn't be it because it gets fast, so this is now.
Because like I was thinking of it being more gradual, but now that I see like it's kind of like
it starts off right here.
Slows down
it
as it widens.
I see the bucket as being kind of more of a gradual.
Yeah.
Kind of, so when it flattens out, that means that there's more, it's a wider area.
Less height.
If it's bigger,
so then it takes longer to get up. That's when it flattens out.
Yeah.
So it ends with it flattening out. So that means that it's definitely E.
Yeah.
Okay, I agree. I'll change my thinking on that one.
Okay.
I knew that there were more graphs than there were containers. So there were three graphs that did not have a container that matched with it. So students were given more information than they needed to find the matches. So one group I noticed was having a hard time coming up with some of the matches. So I gave them the hints, and I told them which graphs did not have a container, and that could narrow their thinking.
So that's okay, now you know that it doesn't.
And so I watched what happened with that group, and once they knew which graphs were eliminated, they were able to re-examine their thinking now that they knew which graphs did not have a container. After I saw how that group reacted, I thought maybe as a class it would be nice if they knew which graphs were eliminated. So I called the class back together and then told all of the class which graphs did not have a container.
And I'm gonna give you another piece of information, actually three pieces of information. I am going to tell you the three graphs that don't have a match.
After giving them a little more time to come up with what they at that point thought which containers went with which graphs, I then invited the class to go and look at what other groups had as their matches. And in doing this, out of the groups of three, I asked one student to stay with their cards. And the reason that I asked someone to stay was so that they could explain the thinking of the group with their visitors. So I gave the class a few minutes to go look around and see what other people, what other groups had come up with.
The wider it is, the slower it's going to go up. So it's going to start really slow. And for this, it goes up at that slow rate for a long period of time. So it goes all the way up here. And then once it hits this corner area, it goes up a little bit and then boom, goes straight up.
I got G for the cutting class.
No.
You see how it's getting wider and then it gets narrower?
Yeah, that means that it's going to speed up. Okay. It means it's speeding up. Look, that's a steady rate. That's not a steady rate.
Yeah, it's G.
I can see you thinking.
And then they all returned to their original group of three. The students were then able to talk about what they saw as they went out and reevaluate their matches based on the thinking of other students. I thought it was interesting that this is probably my favorite part of the lesson was I asked students, I asked the class how many groups had changed their ideas and their thinking after they went and visited with the other groups, and half of the groups had changed their thinking based on what they had seen from other groups. And they talked about how hearing other people's explanations and ideas helped them to think about the problem a little bit different and to make some adjustments to their final thinking.
For graph G and D, because I think that's a lot that we all kind of got confused on. We kind of got mixed up on. And so, but Sadie actually said that G goes like gradually, the graph of gradually. And for the base we chose, it didn't really go gradually. So we didn't think about that. So Sadie actually like opened that up for me, so.
For me, when I was like looking at other groups, I would kind of come back to my group and kind of look and see which ones are different, and I would ask why they had put the different ones for theirs, and listening to their opinions, and like even if I didn't always like agree, listening to their opinions like made me think a little bit more about the choices I had made.
students then went back to their original seats and they had time to take a minute to reflect on the process that they had just been through and to look at their original task and see if they wanted to revise any of their thinking. So students then completed an exit ticket in which they wrote an if-then statement to communicate their thinking and understanding of the ideas about the relationship between the two quantities. So the information that I got from the students at the end of the lesson through their exit slip and also through listening to their conversations and their explanations, my next steps would be to develop the next lesson, and possibly because I was borrowing the classroom and it's not my class, working with the teacher in developing the next steps. As we saw in the lesson today, the level engagement was very high using these grouping strategies. As a classroom teacher, used this strategy of having students work independently first and then work as a small group. I used it a lot so that students had time to process the information individually first, and that way they all had something to bring to the table. I think this could be an effective strategy across grade levels and content areas.